Welcome back to Retro Evolutions. In this episode, we're going to be taking care of building the PSP Pro console. It's a bit of a rehash of the Consolized PSP we did a long time ago. This time we're going to be building five of them, and it's a much better way to do the whole mod and follow along with. We've got some really technical stuff involved here, but it's very easy for you to replicate if you have the right tools, patience, and a little bit of skill. So anyway, we're going to be getting straight into part one, which is with my friend Avalanche Reviews, as we hook into this build series. And sorry this took so long, but I've been a bit ill, but hey, we're back. So enjoy, stay tuned, and hold tight. We'll see you around.
Jared first started batting around the idea of a consolized PSP, I didn't even think it was possible, but now that it's on its way, it might be time to explain why I might want such a thing. And I think the first major reason is the PSP's incredibly underrated library. There's so many hidden gems printed on those odd-looking UMDs, but of course I could play all of those games on an actual PSP, so why consolize it? Well, I live in South Florida, so public transport is not a part of my everyday life. That means when I leave the house, I'm driving, so I really don't get a lot of chances to just whip out a portable gaming device. Plus, there's my ever-present obsession with getting the best video quality out of my consoles. I like running my PSP through my FrameMeister and zooming the picture in far enough to fill my screen. The only problem is that I'm stuck holding my PSP with one cable stretching out of the wall and the other one connected to my TV or component switch. And if that doesn't sound annoying to you, just take your controller of choice and hold it while holding the controller's cable in one hand and your console's video cables in the other. It's definitely not on my list of the most comfortable experiences you can have. So for me at least, a PSP that I can keep on my shelf and lets me play Crisis Core with my favorite PS2 controller is an absolute no-brainer.
Alright, so what we have here is a PSP 2000 donated by VG Collectaholic, and here's what the board will end up basically looking like with the UMD drive on it as well. We're going to fit this inside a PS2 Slim, and we're going to pin out all the buttons and give it some real cool bells and whistles. Extreme Consoles and Mizucat are going to do some wicked paintwork on these, and Logan from Neon Vision's obviously going to do some box work. But we're going to have to pin out all the buttons as follows. So we've got a up, left, down, right, an analog stick, a home button would actually get you back to the main menu, volumes down and up. Now this one's quite important as well, which is your brightness adjustment, but what is awesome about it is if you hold it down, it'll give you a video output. Now this is actually capable of 720p components, so we're going to utilize that, which is amazing. And a select and a start, X, square, triangle and circle buttons. And these crystal clear things up here are your shoulder buttons. You've got a right and a left and stereo out speaker, but that won't be used. We're going to put our sound through the audio jack on this as well. No battery will be present, and we'll have 5V DC feeding the system. Alright, so I'll get into taking this all apart, and we'll get it disassembled and ready for putting some wiring in, which we'll do today, and get it prepped for the next section where we'll interface it with a controller.
Save your breath, I'll move closer to you.
Okay, so now we had the front of it all off. And if you have a close look, you can see these silver pads. These are actually the buttons. So you have the up, the left, the down, the right, and then it goes up to here, which is your L trigger, and your triangle, circle, X, square here, and it goes up into this here. But this ribbon cable is actually shared, and it actually splits out to this power harness. Now I've developed a new way by looking into this further that we don't even need this anymore, and we actually run a wire straight off here. So this is now pretty much obsolete, but I'll start doing more further a breakdown. And what we've also got to look into doing here is taking the buttons off this section, which is fed straight off this ribbon cable here. Mainly the home button, the volume, which will allow for the video out and brightness adjustment, and the start select, and a pin into here. So I'll start taking these all off and we'll get further into it again. Switch back on here, and for a bit of education I'm going to actually show you how this works. We'll hot air rework this off and I'll show you the actual pin configuration. But if you have a look closer here, you can see these pins running off here. If you look at this, we see carefully that actually divides into two sections between this metal strip, which is ground. Everything left of that is your X, triangle, square, circle, and your R button. And then everything to the right of that is to do with the power circuit, LEDs, you know, standby, reset, etc. on there, and then the hard turn on. We're only actually going to use one wire though, and that's the one just to power the device up by pulling it to the ground. Where the advanced soldering techniques I talk about come into play, and the warning I gave at the start of the video. Basically what you have to do is a little bit of flux along here, and we use a technique known as drag soldering, which is the flux will make the solder only stick to the pads, and if you do it fast enough and properly you shouldn't get any bridges. But you can always keep pulling the solder in the direction you're working on. Temptation, escape with me. Okay, so the power switch would normally come up into this harness here, like this wire as I'm showing right now, and would actually cause the power bridge from here to here, and it actually switches to ground to turn it on. So now that demo's sort of showing you what we're going to be doing for most of this, I'll actually start reworking these plugs off. So we're going to have to take this one off, this one right here, this one right here, and the special thing about the PSP 2000, which is quite great, is we don't actually have to remove a plug for the analog stick anymore, you just solder to these pads. Okay, so let's get straight into it and we'll start soldering. Demonstrate how these buttons work by going to ground. Probably the best and easiest one to show you with would be the power on button, so I'll wire that one in first.
Never.
Alright, so we've pinned all the wires that we're going to have to pin off for the PSP here. I've fitted a USB straight into where the power comes in, so we can plug it straight into a USB socket for powering up. I'd use a wall socket generally, a bit more powerful. But at this point anyway, as you can see here, there's some looms, very, very messy ones. And they're just rough to go out to associated buttons like they'd be on a controller, like your left shoulder, your right shoulder, your left down, right up, triangle, circle, X square, start, select, and then volume up and down, and a home button here. And this is your screen output and your on off button. Basically how that all kind of works is each one of the inputs from the PSP will come into this, and the other side of them, as you see this wire that interconnects them all, actually comes out to here, and this whole ring goes around here to pick them all up as a common ground. So this point of this is just basically to test all our buttons are working before we move on to the next phase, which will be mounting it into the Arduino and making it run off original PS2 controllers. So we'll do a little bit of test play and we'll leave you there, and we'll see you next time.